Sandy, yes. Did they trick you into coming here this time?
I've been here four times before. Yeah, I did The King and I here, Peter Pan, and then I did a show here called That's Christmas,
and
it was in the dead of winter.
Okay, so you
I
know
really
Chicago
died.
Too.
I do, actually. Too. I really do. It's like got the best of New York without all this other stuff of New York.
You can say garbage and dirt.
No, because I live there. I can't say that.
I think that says something, though, about Chicago's theater scene, performing live in Chicago, that people love to come here, and they love to do their shows here.
And you can earn a living as an actor in Chicago, one of the few places outside of New York that you can do that. London, Chicago, New York, I don't know where else.
It's not that easy.
Well, it's not that easy anywhere, really. Yeah. Let's face it.
But again, it's
a good working actor town. And Adrian, as you said, I'm shocked at how little there is in L.A.
Yeah, there's more theater per capita here than there is in New York City.
Yes. There's more working actors here.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
But also, too, is like, you know, in coming to Chicago and doing plays here, I think it's such an honest response that you get from audiences. It's not like New York where before anything happens and you walk on the stage and they're not like easily, you know, won over.
You prove yourself. Yeah. What do you got here?
Yeah. Sandy, what have your Chicago experiences been?
Warm, accepting, and supportive. I mean, I've had nothing but good experiences here in theater. And I think, too, you have people attending theater here that are honest theater goers, whereas New York, it's become sort of a tourist attraction. You get a lot of tourists, which nothing wrong with, but it's what Kate was saying.
Donny, what have your Chicago experiences been like? I mean, all of you from Happy Days have been here in Chicago for one reason or another. Yeah. The thing that I remember most, and I love when I answer my own questions that is when you guys, the Happy Days cast, did charity baseball games at Wrigley Field.
Yeah.
Gary Marshall remembered it fondly. Ron Howard remembered it fondly. Henry Winkler, anyone that we've talked to, they loved it. They had so much fun.
Yeah, we did, because I've never had the opportunity to work here on stage. This will be my first time, so I'm really looking forward to it. But yes, those experiences of being with the Happy Days gang and playing at Wrigley, because we had a baseball team, so we were really into the sport, and Tom Bosley was from Chicago, so that was a big thing for him to play at Wrigley. But like Ron and I and Gary, big baseball fans, I mean, we were like kids, you know, in heaven, being able to be at Wrigley Field. I mean, we knew the tradition, the legacy, and all that, so it meant a lot to us.
Yeah. So, Adrian, I purposely left you for last of the Chicago experiences.
You just put a nickel in me, and I'll talk about
Chicago
forever.
Yeah, you may all want to go get some lunch while Adrian talks about Chicago. But literally, we could go out this door right here, and it's a half a block away from where Adrian went to high school over at Lane Tech.
As we were driving up, I was just telling Sandy and Don that my first, when I was a freshman, my first period class was swimming.
Oh my god.
Chicago Public School. I know where this story's going.
And, you know, in 30, you know, wind chill factors at 30 below almost, you know, first class, it was pretty tough and everything. Damn. But the funny thing is, I was just telling the story of how I really got into theater. Lane Tech was an all-guy high school when I was there.
Yeah.
It turned co-ed in my senior year, but I wanted to meet girls. So I said, how do I meet girls? I said, there's a play. There's musicals that they do here, and they import all the girls from Immaculata and Madonna and stuff. So I said, okay, I could always sing in my father's church and everything like that. I'll just sing the net. And I got a part in Guys and Dolls, and that was it. I met girls, and the rest is history. I went to the Goodman to study acting, and it's just so funny. I grew up in this town in the beginning of that theater that what was going on Halsted and Lincoln Avenue and all those little theaters. There was a little show called Grease at the Kingston Mines that nobody knew about, but everybody was, you know, crazy about it. And I decided I was going to go audition for it while I was actually in my last year of high school here. And I got the role of Duty in it. And my father wouldn't let me do it because I was failing in math. So I ended up doing it.
Wow.
I ended up doing Danny about 3 years later after I graduated from the Goodman.
Wow.
I went to New York
to do it. That's amazing. So what was the transition for you then from Lane Tech and DePaul. Did you go to New York? Did you go to L.A.?
Well,
how did you become Adrian Zmed that we know
from? A month after I graduated, I was in the right place at the right time. They needed, it was like a Thursday, and they needed a new Zuko for Danny Zuko to start rehearsals on Monday. And they were, for some reason, they were at the end of, who do we get? Who do we audition now? And somebody at the box office, this is when the Goodman was at the Art Institute before DePaul took it over. There was a lady in the box office who was helping them cast it, saying, I've seen a lot of work that you've done. Come in and just audition for this. I was bartending on Rush Street. I asked the owner if I could just have a lunch hour right after the rush hour, if I could go audition. Went in, auditioned, I got it, and I was in New York 3 days later.
How about that?
Oh, God.
Isn't that amazing?
Wow.
Isn't that amazing?
And so I started off in New York, and then went to Hollywood.
Sandy, what was your route from Texas to some of the amazing things that you did at a pretty young age?
Really young, because I went to New York when I was 18 by myself, but I had a job that I'd gotten through Dallas Summer Musicals. You know, that wonderful role in Music Man, You Gods, uh-huh. Zenita. But anyway,
Dallas
I had
Summer
a job
musicals,
at, New York City Center that I went to, and I stayed at a place called the Rehearsal Club, which I had to audition to get into. It was a girls', dorm, I guess, and men couldn't come above the bottom floor. That was the sitting room, and it was $32 a week, and you got lunch, you got breakfast and dinner. So without that, I don't know how easy it would have been. But I got one job would lead to another, and that's the only way I could have worked because I cannot audition. I stink at auditions.
Really?
Cannot do them.
Really?
I become very shy, and I turn into like a 14-year-old adolescent. Just, oh, I'm like ridiculous. And so luckily, I think I've only had about 15 auditions in my life because I never got them, ever.
Wow.
So it really was a chain of doing a job and getting it, from the last job I did.
That's amazing to me because my first recollections of you were from your own shows, but seeing you on Johnny Carson, seeing you on the talk shows, bubbly, full of life. I mean, like truly America's sweetheart. I had a crush on you. Everybody had a crush on you, back in the day, but really kind of shy and withdrawn, huh?
Yeah. Oh, yeah. And the persona I have is like, woo! That's not really me.
Sandy, are there projects for which you are most proud? I mean, we could go down the list from Peter Pan and all your television roles. If we were to take a poll here at WGN yesterday when we were talking about Sandy Duncan's going to be here, we can't wait, Wheat Thins. Mm. You would have thought that was your Academy Award winning role, your Wheat Thins
commercial.
Well,
it was certainly my money winning award.
Yeah. Yeah.
I like doing a commercial. Yeah. I guess I was with that project for some on and off 15 years.
Wow.
On and off.
Yeah.
But I think my favorite role is Louise in Carousel. I did it with Agnes DeMille choreographing, and I got it over a lot of bun heads. I mean, they were all down to the wire, and I was the only one that was a musical comedy dancer. But I got it, and it was one of the harder jobs I've ever had, but one of the bigger wins because I accomplished it. And she said, "You were very good, darling."
Wow.
She says, "You didn't jump as high as Bambi Lynn, but you were very..." And the guy with her was Philip Burton, who was Richard Burton's adopted father. And he said, "Yes, Agnes, but Sandy knows why she's jumping." It's my favorite compliment I ever got in my whole life.
That's great.
I did Carousel on Broadway with Audra McDonald.
You did?
Yeah. I was Mrs. Mullins.
Of course you were.
Yeah, but knowing why you're jumping speaks volumes.
Yes, it does.
Were you happy with television? Because it seemed like television, you'd get into a great show. I always loved your shows. That's and then it was gone. And I'd love your show. And then it was gone.
Yeah.
And I wonder how difficult that was for you.
The first one was difficult because I got a brain tumor. It had to end after 13. The second one had to be over because it was so bad. And then...
disagree, but...
Thank you. Television has not been my lucky place. It's not like theater. And I like the Hogan Family. I love doing that. I really did. I love the boys. I like the routine of it. Maybe I'll do one when I'm really old. Be somebody's great-grandmother.
Got a pretty long way to go for that.
Working on it.
Loved seeing you on TV. You would be a great talk show host, I bet.
I subbed, actually, for Johnny Carson a couple of times.
See? Oh. Kate, talk to me a little about you're born and raised here. You're also Chicago's very own. Originally from the South Side, right?
Originally from the South Side, and then we moved north, you know, in the late 50s, right. Early 60s.
You saw the light and came to the north.
Well, yeah, my family are Sox fans, most of them, but yeah. I'm a Cubs fan.
Yeah, okay.
You know?
I think you said sex fans.
And
sex. I don't remember what that is, so I can't be a fan of it anymore, you know?
What are your most memorable things that you've done? Because
I think the most memorable or the thing that meant the most to me, I mean, I've been very lucky. So lucky. But I think when I did the original Bug with Michael Shannon in 2001.
Wow.
And we were doing that show, and then, you know, 9/11 happened.
Right.
And it was so like, oh my God, because it's very cathartic, and it was just like, whoa, yeah. You know? And also just being in Little Red Orchid, which holds like what,
right.
60 people?
Truly storefront
and
theater on Wall Street.
You're in your face, yeah. You know, there's no getting away with anything, you know? And, you know, I've had great times with Dennehy and in Iceman and Death of a Salesman, which have taken me great, I mean, there's so many great shows I've done here that have taken me to New York. I mean, now I think about it, most of the shows I've gotten have come from here.
Yeah.
And Chicago doesn't typecast you. Whereas New York and Hollywood,
definitely Hollywood.
You know, after Hooker, I couldn't get arrested in a comedy.
Well, I want to talk to both of you and Don about that, because you're best known for Hooker and Dance Fever, probably on big national basis and the movies, and Don certainly you for Happy Days and other things. Has it been kind of a mixed blessing to be so identified with one role that it almost becomes impossible to be anybody else?
Oh my God, yes.
Yeah.
Oh, it was really hard. I left Happy Days after the seventh season because here I saw what was coming down the pike, and you know, I was doing one character primarily for those 7 years, so my contract was up, and I decided not to return. The show ran for 4 more years. Ron Howard left the same year, but you know, I'm young, I'm 27, and fired up to do a lot of great things, because it was already, by then, when I first auditioned out in L.A., I was getting dramatic parts. You know, I played on Police Story, I played like a mad psycho, and then on Emergency, a kid who became a paraplegic. Then I get Happy Days. 2 years later, I couldn't even audition for any of those roles. Mm. They wouldn't even see me.
Yeah. Right.
So so it was tough. But then when I left, I'm all fired up, and I told my agent, I don't want to do any television, and I just want to do theater and film. I went and I was with a big agency, Willie Morris, a big agent there. I went 6 months, I didn't have one audition.
Wow.
So, you know, it was like, what are you going to do? But I was still holding out, not wanting to, because I felt television back then. Well, I was known for it, and I wanted to get away from the character. But also, I didn't like, you know, the amount of time that you had to work on television. It was so quick, and I felt a lot of the shows were just mediocre, you know. Today, the dramas are much better than they were back then, because they spend so much more time and money on it. But back then, so I didn't want to do any of that, but then I couldn't get auditions.
Right.
So, yes, was it tough? It was.
Imagine being a young actor at that level where you were, had there been Netflix and Hulu and like all these other venues, opportunities that are now available to actors to do,
and
push the envelope.
Absolutely. And now there's more of a bridge between the mediums.
So what was it like for you, Adrian?
Well, I went exactly through the same thing that that Don went through, and that is, especially Hollywood, just pigeonholes you, and that's what you are. They don't want to see anything else except what you were. And if those roles aren't available, then you're just sitting at home twiddling your thumbs. I left Hollywood. I went to theater. Went to New York and spent 12 years there. doing theater after that. And that's where I was challenged. That's where I got roles that Hollywood would never cast me as Seymour in Little Shop of Horrors. That would never happen. They wanted me to do the dentist, but I said, no, I want to do Seymour. I said, well, audition for it. Okay, great, you got it. It's like, it doesn't happen in Hollywood, but it happens in theater.
Yeah. But maybe
that's how I survived this whole thing.
Yeah.
Just going back and forth now, you know, when something does open up, you know, in television or film, that's great, but I'd rather do theater any day.
But maybe the biggest role of your life is right here at 2501 West Bradley Place.
You hit it right on.
Yeah.
I'm so jealous.
How?
And again, two don't know how big that, you know, to have actually been on the Bozo Show. It all started with Alan Hall, the producer, and he knew that I had met him because of doing the national anthem at Wrigley Field or whatever in some way. And then he asked if I wanted to host the MDA telethon here. So I did, and then one thing led to another, and he calls me up and he says, hey, one of our Cookie is very ill right now.
One of our clowns.
Yeah, Cookie is really ill.
Clown number
How
two.
Would you feel about coming in and filling in for him for 4 weeks? We were talking to Bill Murray about it too, and he says, no, I want to do it. I so want to do this. I'm there. I'm on a plane right now. And then that led to him saying, we're going to do the 35th year anniversary special.
Yeah.
And I did that, and I actually won an Emmy
for
that featured role.
So I hear you're also doing a play.
Oh, that.
Right. No, but it's a little, I'm listening to this, and it's not unlike what
the
he's
play.
Talking
yeah, exactly.
about. Right?
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah.
It's about memories and grandfathers and children and events that happen in their lives that, you know, bring you to tears and make you remember. It's a memory kind of play.
It's about two couples who have dinner for over 30 years every Friday night. Hmm. And it's about the roller coaster of life and everything. And I think that in the end, what the show is really all about is teaching you that if you want a friend in life, you have to be a friend. It's a roller coaster as an actor to go in and out.
It's called Middletown, The Ride of Your Life, and is at the Apollo Theater Center in Chicago. 2540 North Lincoln Avenue through March the 22nd. I know I speak for our listeners when I say thank you for taking us on your roller coasters personally and professionally. It's been such a joy to be able to share with some of the great work that you've given us all through
the
years.
Guy.
He's Dean Richards.
He's a Chicago icon, too. He really is.
Wow.
He's been here forever.
Come for the interview, stay for the compliments. Let's do that.